Hello, everyone. It's Michelle Hill with Southern Inspirations. Happy Thursday. I am so honored and pleased to have my special guest today from the Arkansas Peace and Justice Memorial Movement and many other organizations that they're involved in. So would you please help me welcome to the Making a Difference Southern Inspirations show, Kwame and Clarice Abdul-Bey. Welcome, guys. How are you?
Good morning. How are you doing?
Good,
good afternoon, I guess.
Oh, yeah, it's getting close to lunchtime. So if y'all hear tummy growl, we'll keep on going. So again, thank you. I just want to start out. I know that, first of all, just by doing the brief research that I had time to do, y'all are some busy folks.
Oh my God.
you have lots going on these days. Plus your parents, you know.
We're also students, so.
Yes. Look, from this dissertation of history on both of y'all, you are constant learners. And yeah. I'm reading through it and I'm like, oh my goodness, this is a little bit over my head. But welcome everyone that's watching, y'all. I just want to kind of set this up before we dive into the content. We are here today, and I'm going to read, I've got my little cheat sheet over here. I'm going to read exactly what Clarice sent me, because there just is no better way to say it. We are here today to talk about the Arkansas Peace and Justice Memorial Movement. But Kwame and Clarice, it goes much deeper than that, right?
Yes, it does.
And, you know, we want to bring awareness, but we're going to dig beneath the surface. So I'm going to pop up. I put all of this in notes, and I'm just going to read it. I'm going to take our names down for just a second.
Okay.
Because I just think it's so... It just speaks to why we're here, it speaks to the facts, the truth. But y'all, what we want you to know and take away today as you're watching and as you're on replay and you're sharing this is that just because we're in this state, I'll just call it that, this state of unrest,
yes,
craziness in our world today, and the mentality that is just off base, does not mean that we have to stay that way.
Correct.
Okay, so let me find my notes. Let me see here. I loaded them, but y'all, I've got so many notes. Well, I can't find them right now, so I'm just gonna read them. I thought I put them in here. Okay. So, Clarice, with your permission, I'm going to read exactly what you sent me. Arkansas has a history of being the third most deadliest state for Black people when it comes to racialized violence in the form of lynchings. And I'm going to just stop right there, because this is a transparent, organic, natural conversation for the purpose of bringing education, truth, facts, hope, and healing.
Yes.
I did not know this.
Well, we actually learned it ourselves within the last 2 years. We homeschool our children, and our oldest child, Dreema, she was graduating from high school. So she had a graduation, quote unquote, dissertation,
right,
that she was required to do. And as part of that, she wanted to go to Montgomery, Alabama, to the new lynching museum Attorney Brian Stevenson had created. So we took a family trip to the museum, and there, oh my God, it was a very somber, powerful, and overwhelming experience for us, and for us to learn that Arkansas had 492 documented lynchings in its history, 492, more than Texas. And like I said, documented means that they were able to find two separate sources that confirmed the lynching happened. So it probably was a lot more than 492.
Well, I was going to say, that's the key word, is documented. I'm sorry, Clarice.
Oh, I was saying we've since, that went April, May of 2018.
Yeah,
2000. We've since, working with historians here in Arkansas, found that there are more than 492 of our community members and people here in the state of Arkansas who have been, or actually Black people, of course, who have been victims of racial terror lynchings in our state.
Right.
So that is very daunting, and it was very overwhelming, and it was like visiting a graveyard. If I could describe it that way, because everyone who came in, the energy was like visiting a graveyard.
I can't even imagine the emotions in that moment as you stood there, and forgive my terminology here, it almost probably slapped you upside the face as far as, wow, seriously, the natural state, our home state where we live and work and play, are you kidding me?
Yes. And so what we did is, traveling back to Little Rock, the drive from Montgomery, Alabama to Memphis, Tennessee was totally silent because we were just trying to digest what was going on. And then the drive from Memphis to Little Rock was, okay, now what are we going to do about it? We have been transformed. What are we going to do about it? So by the time we arrived back home, we had founded the Arkansas Peace and Justice Memorial.
Yeah. Well, and that brings up something that I say both to myself and quite honestly not out loud enough, and that is, with awareness comes responsibility.
Yes, yes.
And once we, and even as I sit here in this space, I literally have chill bumps right now, and I'm not just saying that to try to be dramatic, but I have to look in the mirror and I have to tell myself again and again, with awareness comes responsibility. Yes. What do I plan to do about it? What is my place in the healing and the reconciliation? And so that's why I titled this Healing Together, because I really mean that. Now, granted, it's not going to happen overnight.
Yeah.
There's so much still need to learn. And, you know, we've used that word overwhelmed, and you referenced that as far as making the trip to that museum. That's how I feel right now, not just with your organization, but just in general. As a white individual and as a white female, I myself, have I had my head in the sand? Have I not educated myself or not enough or not cared enough to learn more? And here's the two key words, before now.
Yes.
I'm so encouraged just by the spirit that you both have, because I know that that's your heart, is that, hey, what do we do about it? You said it best, Kwame. It's like, what do with this now? Okay, I want to finish reading this. We stopped off at talking about the lynchings, because this is why we're here, guys and ladies. If you're watching today, right now, what we're dealing with is the most opportune time for us to accept the truth. This is documented, and like you said, we only know of 492. Deal with it. You guys begun that journey to deal with it through this museum and this movement, mm-hmm. and begin to heal from that truth together. Because here, this next sentence that I'm going to share is really at the core of where we all are right now with racial unrest and everything else that's going on in our world. Today's culture has ingrained within each of our psyches an us versus them mentality. When I read that, Clarice, I'm like, that is so exactly right. And again, I took a moment just to reflect on my own mentality and beliefs and, as you call it, ideological teams of division. Have I been frequency of talking, you know, at others instead of with each other. So speaking of that, this is about all the talking that I want to do on this episode right now, because I really want you guys to, I just wanted to have a good setup, and I hope I didn't carry that too far, but I really want to be quiet and I want to learn. I just want you to share your hearts and use this time to tell us more about the museum, as you feel led, the youth organization that you run, the Ouachita Foothills Youth Media Arts and Literacy Collective. Woo! That's absolutely too. And what you are working to do every day. And then very importantly, share how we can help as the public, as your allies, as those coming alongside of you. I really just want to give you that space. So y'all just share. And thank you again.
Well, thank you, Michelle. We really appreciate you reaching out to us and really wanting to show that you are in solidarity with what it is, the push and the, I would say also, in trying to really bring together. And we talk about reconciliation a lot, but we like to use to reconcile, because for us, you can't really reconcile something that was never established in the first place, never really established. Yes. And that's our racial bonds and racial relationships with each other. And right now we're dealing with our relationship with law enforcement. And historically, our relationship with law enforcement has not been a good one in the Black community. There's a lot of distrust, there's a lot of issues. And we know that from history. We know why it was put together. It was, you know, it was slave catching and it was all of those things. So that organization was put together for that reason. And we never had really a trusting relationship with law enforcement like we need to. So, right. And then with that, it spills over into our other community relations with our white community being real allies with us in the movement of trying to reconcile our relationships. So we hear reconciliation a lot, and we are partnered with the Equal Justice Initiative in Alabama. But for us, we need to reconcile our relationships here in Arkansas, because we've never had that true partnership and true connection with one another. And that's very important for us.
You know, one thing that you talk about, the historical relationship with law enforcement in the Black community. Mm-hmm. I like to use the science of etymology. And when you look at the word police means policy. So you know the policy of your government by how the police act. And if the police act a certain way, what they're doing is they're enforcing the governmental policies. They may be written or unwritten, but they are the representative faction in the general public of what the government really and truly stands for. So when you look at the police, you get an opportunity to see what the policies of the government are. So if those policies deal with inequality, if those policies deal with inequitable environments, if those policies deal with us versus them, then that those policies will manifest in the police. So yes, this is something where at this day and time, you hear things like defund the police, and you hear things like, dismantle or abolish the police. But really at the core of it, it's we're trying to change the policy that make the police do what they do and act the way they act. So yes, the police is the tip of the iceberg, but there's a whole bunch of stuff underneath that that we're trying to address.
Go ahead.
I was just going to say, to speak to both of the, what you talked about, the word reconciliation and then the police being the policy. I've never heard it broken down that way. And Clarice, that your comment about you can't reconcile what you've never had.
Yes.
Truly, and I'm guilty. I've already used the word reconciliation in this conversation multiple times, and even in the written form, perhaps promoting some other things that I've promoted. And so even that nugget right there, game changer for me. And I just wanted to take a second and acknowledge that. And thank you for breaking it down in layman's terms for just, we're just talking real stuff. And Kwame, you're so correct. And you're exactly right there. And it makes me think it's really no different talking about the police. It's no different than an organization or a business or a group. If there are no formal policies or procedures or structures in place that address, here's the key, there may be policies, but certain components.
Yes.
There's been a lack thereof. So just wanted to interject that I appreciate the way that you guys are breaking that down to me. So go ahead. I know you're about to say something else.
Oh, I was just going to say that our goal as APJMM is the first one is to memorialize victims of historical racialized violence in the state of Arkansas. So that's what our goal is. That's one of our goals. And that's through our geographical and genealogical research and soil collection and historical markers and our descendant acknowledgement with conciliation.
Okay.
And so that's one of our goals. Our secondary goal is to promote community wide engagement, and through the educational, like we say, edutainment, education, arts, and interracial dialogue. And we are one of the Arkansas-based coming to the table.
We are the
right coming to the table in the state. Well, in this state, that was formed, and Kwame knows more history, but it was basically formed with the descendants of Thomas Jefferson and
black and white descendants. Black and white, of Thomas, right. Thomas Jefferson.
And
Sally Hemings.
Sally Hemings. He's the real historian. Sally Hemings. And so they formed this organization called Coming to the Table to have conversations about racial issues and how we could work together and how we can be in solidarity on issues of race. And so with this great organization, we wanted to bring it here because we were, as APJMM, getting an influx of calls and letters from the white community saying, hey, we want to have a conversation. Like this information that you're providing, we didn't know anything about, especially in our state. We want to sit down and we want to talk it, and have made many allies and friends from the white community basically calling and saying, and I mean very how do I say it? Lamenting by the fact that this is a hard subject.
Yes.
I'm crushed by it. I never realized my privilege in this. I've lived here for all my life. I've been a white male or female for, you know, as long as I can remember.
At least I got my membership card in the mail.
I never saw how my white privilege was affecting other communities.
Communities. That's exactly, yep.
And you know, with the history of Arkansas and the things that have happened, you have to be one thing. We have friends, and we've had other, especially our feminist friends who have said to us, "Why waste your time, you know, talking to male white male men about issues of race when they are the cause mainly?" And these are conversations. To me, the coming to the table piece is, we can't reconcile things if we don't have a conversation. We can't completely shut the door to any type of coming together and living together and working together to fight racial issues in our state if we don't have conversations.
Right.
If we can't come and be real with one another and say, look, you know, we've ignored this far too long. You've ignored it. Here's your privilege. Here's how it affected my community. Or you say, we didn't know, you know, or you know what I'm saying? Or we just, we were raised this way. We don't, whatever the issues are, we want to put them on the table so conversations, raw, real conversations can be had. And of course, boxes of tissue are always, always.
I hope I don't need them right now, but I might.
and so we won't do anything that will. We want real conversations, and so we want to make sure that we're not covering up the issues. We don't. You know, we're not sugarcoating and we're not pacifying. That we're all being very real and what our history has been and also our personal experiences.
Well, and you said, I'm sorry, go ahead, Kwame.
No, you please, you.
Well, this, I wanted to pull out of that two other words that you used two other phrases, because it's being thrown around a lot right now. And that is allies, and that is white privilege. Mm-hmm. And so there are a plethora of resources out there right now, you know, 75 ways to be a best white ally, you know, all of these things are out there.
Yeah.
I think it's genuine. I mean, I'm genuine in asking that I do better. And so I'm not, you know, making light of that. But this is two part. So how, from your perspective, your history, what you know as a couple, as Black individuals, give us some everyday, realistic, practical things what we can do to be allies. That's number one. And number two, this thing about white privilege, I'll share a quick story about that. I'm one of the ones. And I mean, I've seriously? I mean, I'll tell you, just very raw in the beginning, I'm like, whatever. Like, what? Mm-hmm. I've had a hard life. Nobody knows what I've had to go through to. I'm not just this, you know, white, blonde white woman that gets everything handed to her on a silver spoon. What do you mean, white privilege? I mean, that's just me being real and processing that. And in the middle of processing that, I picked up the phone because I have some very close Black friends, male and female, I always have. Mm-hmm. I picked up the phone and called one of the ones that I'm probably the closest to. And I just said, we need to talk. Mm-hmm. I mean, it was about a month ago. I said, you know me, we're fixing to lay it out. And she lays it out to me. And I said, do I have white privilege just because I'm white? Like, you know, my background, you know, my personal and professional struggles. And she said, yes. Mm-hmm. And so we had a conversation from there. So I just wanted to interject that because I'm just now on my journey. And it goes back to that, with awareness comes responsibility. And so now that I'm aware that I have this white privilege. It's almost, I hate to call it a grief process. That's probably a horrible example, but it's I can't deny the fact. I've got to come to terms with that fact and work my way through that. And that's why I reference grief, because you have the different stage. Not that I'm trying to use, that's like a horrible analogy. I just couldn't
it's actually not. really, it's actually not, because that's the process that most people will go through with a realization or an awakening. Right. Sorts.
There you go. An enlightenment. Right. Right.
Yes.
So what exactly. Do I do with it now? It's like, what do I do with it now?
Right.
Well, the reason that it's a grief process is because this is a societal thing, and we're all suffering from structural violence. And that structural violence, the structure is on a foundation of white supremacy. And that white supremacy goes way back, generations before any of us were even thought of. So we're all victims. The thing is that the victimization of the marginalized segment of our society, which would be the black people, it would be the brown people, it would be people of color. Our victimization is so raw, it's so physical, and it's so apparent. And as you just articulated, your victimization is that you are been walking around basically daydreaming for the last several decades. And you've just been forcefully awakened. And I think that when we come to the table and we start talking about this, we all need to be empathetic of our own victimization instead of attacking each other, instead of blaming each other, because we need you just as much as you need us. We're together, and we need to work together. And there's some things that you can do with your white privilege that will help our situation, that we do not have access to that type of power.
Right, and it's not, to echo what Kwame is saying, is the grieving process. For our communities, we've never stopped grieving.
Yeah.
And if you think of it, if you look at that, and when you start learning those things, and you come into an awakening, it is very painful. Because if you're saying I'm a good person, you know what I mean? I have friends of color. I'm kind. I'm generous. I do all these things. But understanding that there has been a privilege set up for you, like the starting line has been set, and we are behind that curve.
Well, to that end, in this same conversation that I had with my friend, I also asked her very specifically, because she made a couple of comments that I can't recall at this moment, but my response to those comments was, has it always been this way? Have you always felt that way? You know, I'll use your word, being behind or whatever, you know, there's lots of different terminologies. And she said, oh yeah, girl. And mm-hmm. I said, give me some examples. Like I needed to feel and experience it, y'all. And mm-hmm. I have chill bumps, and I hope I don't cry, because she is such a special friend to me.
Yes.
And so to hear her share real life experiences that she's been through professionally and personally, not that she was abused or, you know, clearly not lynched, you know, but still what she experienced was real. And she's a single mother. And so she also shared some points with me, how she has to prep her children in certain situations before they go into public.
Right. Yes.
The talk.
We call it the talk in our community.
Yes. And I'm like, what? And that was another one of those things. I'm like, you literally, and her hair, we talked a lot about her hair and how she has to tone it down in certain situations. And so she can't, you know, be herself. And so all these things, my head has been spinning. So you just, every time you say something, Clarice, it's resonating back to either that conversation or a video. I've been watching some videos. I've joined a new, fairly large entrepreneurs group that's I know it's nationwide. I think it's actually worldwide. And one of the requirements, and this just blesses my heart to even become a member, is that you have to watch a series of videos that all point back to Black Lives Matter.
Right.
These are awesome. Individuals sharing their stories. And I sat and watched one yesterday on a lady. I don't recall where she's from or her name, but she talked about how when she got ready to run for office, you know, I would think something about it, but I would exercise caution, but I would not think to the extent that she had to think about going door to door with my pamphlet saying, please vote for me.
Right.
When her and her two young Black sons went out into a neighborhood that was not theirs, let's be real, and she said, keep your hands up here. You know, this is how your shirt's going to look. This is how, you know, you have to be very, very mindful, because at no time do I want to put us in a position that, you know, somebody calls the cops on us or they think that we're there for any other reason other than to campaign.
Right.
Yes. And, you know, we have real examples of what she feared. Trayvon Martin, Ahmaud Arbery, those are two clear examples of people being in a neighborhood where they were believed that they did not belong there, and then a violent that led to their deaths. And that's real stuff. When our son, our 5-year-old son, he'll be 5 in a couple of weeks. But when he was born, that's the first thing that I had to come to grips with, is I have a Black male that I have to raise, and I have to give him that talk, not on a weekly or monthly basis, but basically on every hour of the day. And I have to keep ingraining it in him. So we in the Black community, we train our children and prepare them for police-citizen interactions. And wow. One of the things of the Black Lives Matter movement is all we're asking is, now, since we train our children, you train the police so we can both be trained on how to interact with each other.
Right.
And for us, it is, you know, I really want that information, that the videos and the organization and that you work on, because I think
okay, I'll get that to you.
And amazing. We also, with the Coming to the Table Arkansas chapter, have books and also different literature and also videos for the group that we've collected or that have come together, so that they can be, and we can all be educated on what it is we need to know about one another, especially if you're looking for historical facts and information. It's similar to the group that you are working with right now, and I think that's awesome, but we are doing that same thing, and had our first meeting about 3 weeks or so ago with a group of multi-level racial group of individuals who were very passionate about making a difference and really, you know, making things happen and not just talking, because that's not what we're doing. Like, we all have a conversation, but we have action steps. Like, we want things to move. And you ask about, you know, what are some things that you can do for us? It's very important that we impart those things, or we express how important it is that you do. Number one, use your voice. Use your privilege. That, for us, that's very important. when you come into the enlightenment of the fact that you've always had this, you've always been able to get the things that you need done with no issue. Use that to help assist organizations and communities that need the help. Give back in some way and help organizations that are trying to change the issues, trying to control and change the narrative in a positive way that will benefit the community. That's the main thing I think for us takeaway for you to do. Just like if, for example, we call them Karens. Oh, this is the joke.
Wait a minute. Y'all let me be real. I thought that was a white thing.
All over the world.
See,
it's a whole label of Karen.
Poor Karen.
If Karens in the world can pick up a phone and call the police who are put in place to protect them, because of their privilege,
right,
and because of their place in this society, if they can do that, they can also, so know the power first. They can also, when you come into that enlightenment, know that you also have the power to change things. Legislation, we need you. 93rd Assembly is coming up in 2021. January, we need your voice. Get behind bills and ordinances or whatever it is in the community that's helping the communities of color. Get behind those things and black people. We need more education. I mean, as far as Arkansas, the education here, we don't even know what's going on. And that's the sad part is our educational system, as far as in our public schools, are very flawed. And there's a divestment in our public schools, in our community. Our community schools are being shut down for the option of charter schools or schools that basically you get the money from our children and then send them back to public schools or other schools with no, you know, just with no investment in right. the lives of our children. And so we have to be very intentional with the power that you have. You have to be very intentional in saying, I'm going to use my voice. This is what I'm going to do. And do it in a way that it's genuine and not because it is your, we get this a lot, you know, we get people doing things for charitable reasons. We need things done because it is the, and I'm a curse, damn right thing to do. It is what needs to happen. And it is, right. It's a moral and ethical issue. Right. It's an issue of humanity, not of charity. And that's where we have to focus, is our issues of humanity, not charity. It's not cool just to be a part of clubs to do things for children in Africa and other places when our communities are burning down around us. We have to invest in our own communities.
Yes, and when Clarice talks about humanity, that's when we get into the understanding that Black Lives Matter is, that phrase is used because, like we said, we're all victims, but the Black lives are far more victim is, if we talk about quantity, our victimization is pales in compared to the victimization that you have in your daydream situation. So Black Lives Matter is there because if Black lives don't matter, then nobody's lives matter. So one thing that really pisses me off is when we hear that, oh no, all lives matter and blue lives matter. First of all, blue lives don't matter because blue lives is a uniform, it's not a life. There's nobody walking on this earth right now that doesn't play in Star Trek that is has blue skin.
Right.
So let's stop the blue lives matter.
Right.
Black lives matters. It's intentional. And when Black Lives, when we start working towards the issues that are brought up in this Black Lives Matter movement, everybody wins. Everybody wins when our government functions the way it's supposed to. Everybody wins when our police function the way they're supposed to. Everybody wins when we have legislation and policy that is equitable and that everyone is addressed in our laws and in our regulations and in our policies the way that they need to be addressed as far as health, safety, and welfare is concerned. The reason you need to support Black Lives Matter is because Black Lives Matter, like I said, it's the tip of the iceberg, but once you get underneath the surface, all people will benefit from what Black Lives Matter is trying to set forth.
And in no way are we ever saying that, because I'm a native Arkansan and also a native indigenous family.
Yes, we are.
So that we know the history of that.
Right.
And never will we ever try to diminish the history of any culture that has been attacked and had to experience racial violence in any way. We are never doing that. And that's not what that means. And I think it's frustrating to hear when we're trying to voice how very important it is for Black Lives Matter to be an important issue for our communities and for white communities.
Right.
It's because if you tell us that, if you come with All Lives Matter, what you're doing is you're telling us that you're basically dismissing the importance of what we've had to deal with for over 400 years. So for us, speaking and saying that, it's never to diminish or disrespect anybody's struggle,
right,
or anybody's apartheid. Never that. It's to let you know that we've been in this for far too long. And mm-hmm. and it's not important, and it's not important enough to be at the forefront of issues so that we can go back to the conciliation between us,
right.
And especially in Arkansas, when we're third in racial violence, we really got to get on the ball with working together and changing things, because there's an uprising coming. It's here. And we have to be able to come to the table and talk to one another, because it's not slowing down.
Right.
Nobody is stepping back.
Yeah.
It's here and it's coming, and our young people are not taking it. Black or white, know that.
Right.
They are not. And there have been white community members who have said, you know, whose grandchildren in the Gen Z and the millennial generation, who are calling them out on their racism and on their bigotry and their privilege and begging them to use it, Black and white,
right,
and in all colors, but mostly we can see our white community of young people are rising up against it because they're just sick of it.
Yeah.
Why do we have to live in a world that honors broken systems? Like, we want to get along. Like, we love each other. We want to be together. We want to be able to exist and live. And if we can't do that, then we talk about environmental justice. All of that is connected. That is all connected. Environmental, racial justice, that's all connected. If we can't get that right, how are we to live here together? How are we to fight together to save our world and our environment? We can't.
Right.
You can't do it alone. We can't do it alone.
Right.
We have to all do it together. And that's important.
I like the way that you talked about Monitoring broken systems. That was,
I did too. Yeah, it's so true. Well, thank you again for breaking that down, particularly as it pertains to Black Lives Matter versus the All Lives Matter, because you're exactly right. It's like, well, for me, it's like, well, duh. Nobody has to say all lives matter. Of course we matter.
Yes.
So yes. What is the point? By saying that, you're trying to squash the fact that Black individuals have been marginalized. There's been, you know, systemic racial injustice for years and years and years and years. And if you just flippantly dismiss the fact that not just as a movement, but those three words, Black Lives Matter. That's the way that I am choosing. Yes, it is a movement, but I want to be a white individual, an ally, a Christian based, you know, my faith. I want to be an individual that lives like that, that Black lives matter.
Yes, they do.
And that's because, yeah, like I said, nobody has to say all lives matter. So it's my intention to continue to come alongside you as I can in spaces that make sense, where I can use my gifts, skills, talents, abilities, whatever that is, you know, my platform, yes, to educate, to inform, to bring facts, truth, but in a way that we present it as hope.
Yes.
And a future. I'm going to call it a future now instead of a reconciliation, a future that looks completely different.
Yes.
Past and the present, because Clarice, you said it. It's not going away. Unfortunately, it's very sad that it's not going away anytime soon. And it's going to take us one by one by one. Yes. It's going to take scenarios like this right here, where, and this is not to pump myself or bring glory to myself, so please don't take it that way, but it's going to take us privileged white people,
yes,
raising our hand, picking up the phone, emailing, whatever, and saying, Kwame and Clarice, you don't know me, but yes, let's talk.
Yes,
indeed.
And you've got to reciprocate. You, as Black, yes, individuals, have got to have the heart, the spirit, the willingness, mm-hmm, the vulnerability, the,
yes,
transparency, to and almost like, to me too, you're taking a risk of relationship.
Yes. Yes.
You want the relationship, but there's got to be a trust factor. And for years, it's almost like you've been programmed not to trust.
Yes.
You know, and so it requires this coming together on both sides.
Yes.
For the healing process to start, and I'm going to rewind all the way back. Almost, we're 49 minutes in. Long. It would go this long. I'm going to rewind to where we started out, that you can't have reconciliation on something that never had a bond to begin with.
Yes.
Right. Here we are in 2020. That just blows my mind, the fact that 2020, and we're talking about, we need to build a bond now. Why on God's green earth have we had to wait this long and let our society get to this point to start the bond?
Yes.
Yes.
Woo! Okay, that's my soapbox.
Yeah, and you're talking about that.
Go ahead.
You're talking about that future and how we here in Central Arkansas, specifically in Little Rock, can start working towards the future that you speak on is we all need to educate ourselves, both Black and white, but more particularly white, educating ourselves on the history of redlining. Redlining is a process where the it's legal segregation. Mm-hmm. And it started here in Little Rock. Mm-hmm. And it started with the construction of I-630. I-630 was a part of a redlining project by the federal government where they separated the races and the classes. Because if you go south of I-630, you see a totally different environment than you do when you go north of I-630. So what we need to do is in working towards that future is we need to be focusing all of our resources, our time and our energy in equitably addressing what's going on south of I-630. And we're actually working on putting together a city ordinance to put it in front of the city board of directors to create a 1.5-2 cent sales tax for the next 15-20 years that will go towards funding, revitalizing and redeveloping the landmass south of I-630. And also if you go on Highway 10, the Pankey addition as well. And that's something that's really something that white privilege can start right now in picking up the phone, calling the mayor, calling all of the city directors saying, hey, we need to equitably address south of I-630 and we need to start now. We need to start today. You know, if you aren't aware, south of I-630 has no grocery store whatsoever. It's called food apartheid.
Right.
The last grocery store south of I-630 closed in 2013 or 2014. So people that live south of I-630, the closest grocery store would be the Rodney Perrin Kroger. I think so. That's the closest grocery store that they have. Kroger on Rodney Perrin. That's the closest one. Now, that's for them to eat fresh food.
Right.
At a reasonable price. But in those that cannot make it there because of transportation issues, then they have to eat non-fresh food, highly processed foods at the gas station or whatever, right. That's full of sugar, full of salt.
Right.
So that's where we get our health issues from as far as the diabetes.
Oh, my goodness.
The bad blood and everything. So that's one thing that we all can start dealing with that is tangible.
And I think I'm with you 100%. Yes. And I think more so, well, to echo that the investment in communities who are already there that have been divided to be there and pushed out of communities before I-630 into the other side of I-630, and the investment has not been there. So for us, the investment into those communities, instead of coming in and gentrifying those communities and taking that over and making everything to where it's unaffordable for anyone, right, in the communities that live there, and to push them further out is inhumane. And so we have to be able to look at that and say, okay, instead of us coming in and putting up coffee shops and things that people can make or live without, but what about a grocery store? What about things that are tangible? What about laundromats? I mean, the laundromat in South Elm, Maine was completely tore down. And that laundromat was a main source for that entire community. Okay. Mm-hmm. And so if we're going to be real about it, let's talk about things like that, like the resources and access that's needed. And those are real, very important conversations that we need to have. For me, and I'm going to say this so that you can wrap it up, is that one main thing that is important is the toughest conversation you can have is to have it with your family about racial issues.
Yes.
If you come from a family that generationally the issue has been race, equity, and other issues, then the toughest conversation you can have. It's easy to link up with organizations and talk with your Black friends and talk to other people and other people who are allies or progressive about racial issues and making things happen, because they're on it, they're right on top of it, they're with you. But to get intimately with your family,
your racist ass Uncle Joe.
Well,
you need to have a conversation with him.
She has a show on.
But, you know, I told y'all we will keep it real on here.
Right, right. to have a conversation at a table, or just have a conversation with a family member that you know that these things have been covered up and other stuff, and that you are swept under a rug, or right. you know what's going on. And that's what we have conversations about. We say that that's the toughest conversation that you can have,
yeah.
but you have to have that conversation. That's how you know that you are really stepping into that real work of undoing racism. That's the only way you're going to know, is to look back and to have a conversation with family members and people you love.
Right.
It's easy to talk to other people. It is very hard to talk about racial issues with family because of the, you know, the love and the relationship, and you don't want to lose that, but you got to be willing to lose
right.
this time. We're losing a lot of things, but we have to push past that for what's right, for what we need to do to come together.
One of my most favorite authors in my 20s was Stephen Covey, The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People. And one of the things that he stresses is the importance of principle-centered leadership. And so we have to figure out what are the principles that we're going to move forward on as a society for that future that you just mentioned. And then we have to be steadfast in upholding those principles.
Right.
And those in our families, those in our communities, those in our neighborhoods, those in our cities who refuse to willingly abide by those principles, we're going to have to deal with them, you know, we're going to have to deal with them some way or another, but we're going to have to deal with them.
Exactly. Wow. Oh my goodness. Y'all. I anticipated a lot and I got so much more. I'm absolutely. My heart is full, but at the same time, it's also sad.
Yeah.
It's sad that we're having to deal with this right now. Some of the things you guys have mentioned during the course of our time together today, I've begun the journey for a person. Other things that you've mentioned, this girlfriend's got a little way to go.
Yeah.
so I transparently admit that. But every day I am going to work on it. Every day I want to do my part. To step out in faith, and sometimes even step out in fear,
yes.
break cycles, to crush the norm, if you will, and to affect change for my grandchildren. I have a new granddaughter.
Yeah, congratulations.
Thank you. And to affect change for Lorne.
Yes.
And for all, I can't look through the lens of only affecting change for people who look like me mm-hmm. and my family. It's mm-hmm. got to be for all of us, for again, true healing to take place. And y'all, that's what we need, because the hurt runs deep.
Yes, it does.
Yes. And I like the way that you mentioned your grandchild and our child. When we move in the mindset of the ancient indigenous cultures, that they did not make any decision that they did not sit down and think about how that decision affect the next 7 generations. So we need to be very intentional in, like, okay, how do we move forward so that the next seven generations can benefit from what we're doing?
Absolutely. I want history to show that this moment in time might have been a hell of a year, you know, for many different reasons, but it was also a very productive moment in time.
Yeah.
That real mindsets change. And I'm glad you used that word, Kwame, because that's another word that's going on right now. But I have been doing a lot of work because as we think, such we act.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So what are those thoughts and those patterns and those and mindsets? It's just a good word. You know, what's ingrained into me, whether it was from my childhood, whether I adopted it myself, you know, whatever it was, breaking those down and pulling them apart, questioning them when they need to be questioned, and replacing them with a new thought, a new pattern that will therefore change the behaviors, change the way I look at a Black man coming toward me. If I'm out walking on a street by myself, again, we could get into a whole nother, round two. Hey,
I know, because I've experienced that for the last 50 years. Car doors locking and everything.
Yeah, I mean, it's real stuff. And that's the kind of conversation that I've got to have with myself and with my family to break all that nonsense down. So, okay. I want to end this on two things. One, if you'll give us a challenge, would you leave us, your white allies, but really for everybody, because again, we want to stress here that it's together. It's for everybody, both sides, all sides. What's a challenge, something practical we can do immediately? And the number two, and we'll end on this, tell us something specific we can do to support the organization itself. What's a need right now that anyone can help fill?
Okay. The first thing, what you can do right now is you can Google Coming to the Table.
Okay.
And when you go to their website, you can sign up to be a member. And then when you become a member, the national office will forward your information to us. And we right now, since George Floyd was murdered, we now we went from three members in our local Coming to the Table to we now have 48 members. So we need to we need more members, more people that's willing to come to the table and have these discussions that we're having right now, and then strategize and come up with a game plan. So we need everyone to join Coming to the Table. That's what you can do right now, right this moment.
So let me make sure I understand that correctly, Kwame. This is something national, but there is a local.
Yes, it's a national organization, and APJMM is the local chapter, the Arkansas chapter of that organization.
I got it. Okay, just want to make sure I had that right. Okay, sorry to interrupt.
No problem. The next thing that you can do is Clarice and I, all the work that we do with APJMM, with Arkansas Peace and Justice Memorial Movement, and with Ouachita Foothills Youth Media Arts and Literacy Collective, 95% of the funding comes out of our pockets. We do have a nonprofit, but I work 60, 70 hours a week in order to fund what we're doing. Clarice, she also works as well. So we fund this completely out of our pockets. And if you guys want to make sure that we continue what we're doing and we actually accelerate our activities, you can go to our website, apjmm.org.
Let's see. Here we go, right here.
Okay.
Well, yeah, there's a link to donate.
Okay.
And, you know, definitely donate to what we're doing so that we can not only continue doing it, but we can do it at an accelerated rate. To be very honest with you, I would like to see one day when we don't have to go to work, when we can do this work of social justice, racial justice, 24/7 from our office here in our home, and we don't have to go clock in someplace else. So the only way that we can do that is if we have the proper funds to do that, because we do have a mortgage and a car note. And that 5-year-old boy really likes to eat.
Oh, my goodness.
The books that, for me, it's pretty simple, and I'll keep it really short. But some of the things that Kwame was talking about and some readings, we're ordering books now for our Coming to the Table group. And some of the books that were mentioned were some of these that we, these little books that Coming to the Table National Organization provide.
I'm gonna pop those in. So we have the Little Book of Racial Healing.
Yes.
All right, who's the author?
The author of this is Lisa Church. Racial Healing. Oh, sorry. Thomas Norman DeWolf.
Norman DeWolf. Yeah, I'll pop that up so everybody can have this as reference.
Right.
Okay.
And then here's another one, Race and Restorative Justice.
Hold on, I put Norma instead of Norman. Let me fix that real quick. Oh, my mercy. Hold on just a second. I just want this to really be up here so people can go back and write it down. Okay, now we got it right. Okay, now I'm ready for the next one.
The Race and Restorative Justice.
Little Book of Race and Restorative Justice.
They're
really quick reads. They're not very thick books. They are packed full of really awesome information for you to get quick information on different topics like race and restorative justice.
And these books are books that you will get when you become a member of Coming to the Table.
I gotcha.
And
okay.
Then this one is racial. Well, we did racial healing already.
Yeah.
Dialogue for difficult subjects.
How to have these
conversations.
Oh, that's got the author. I'm just not even gonna worry about the author.
Yeah.
And on Amazon.
Right. Yeah. So back in real quick last year, we did tools for teaching, learning and teaching difficult history for about 75 or so teachers from all over the state of Arkansas.
And we did that in partnership with the Butler Center. Mm-hmm. The Central Arkansas Library Systems Butler Center.
Oh, wow.
And, George
West.
Who is a dear friend of ours. And he, that was amazing. And so the Dialogue of Difficult Subjects is a good book because we talked about those things and historians were there giving the history of Arkansas. But we came on the back end also talking about the programs that you can use in your classroom to help facilitate difficult history. Okay, to answer your question, for me, it's simple. Be brave.
Oh.
Be brave. It's very important that we all are very brave and very intentional.
Be vulnerable. Be brave and be vulnerable.
Very intentional in how we approach each other, how we approach issues of race and racial violence, issues of privilege. Be brave. And that's very important. That word, that statement for me, it creates an energy for me and for other people. I hope it is something that you latch on to because we're going to need bravery to get through this. Like we can be afraid.
Right.
And we can have all of the, I mean, anytime we are approaching a situation or facilitating, there is a serious nervousness that's there. But we know that once we hit that room full of people, that we have to be brave because what we're doing is we're facilitating relationships. and that we're facilitating healing and restoration.
Absolutely.
When we go out into the world, and as you go out into the world, and I'm speaking to the white community, you have to be brave. You have to be brave with your family. You have to tell people, I don't agree with that.
And I will not stand.
Right, I will not stand for it. And this is what I stand for, and I won't change it.
That's going back to those principles that I talked about.
Right. So bravery for me is important. And also those things that we talked about how important it is that we are talking to our legislators, our city directors, our mayor, our government.
Justices of the peace.
Right. Our governor, everybody, the people who are making these different ordinances and things in our community that make a difference, that change the narrative for people of color, Black people. So Absolutely. We have to use our collective voices and be brave.
Wow. I can think of no better advice than that. So thank you for sharing that. Y'all, this may go down as the longest episode. And we mentioned the Ouachita foothills.
Yeah.
but we may have to have another episode just to talk about that organization, because both of you have done and continue to do so much work with youth, speaking of the next generation. And so side note that if I don't reach out to you and say, hey, let's do round two for me, because we need round two to talk about that fabulous organization. But with that, thank you again. This has been, again, all that and more. It's gone way beyond my expectations. I feel like I have two new friends.
Yes. Please call us whenever.
You do.
I will. I cannot wait to be able to see you in person and learn even more and continue just to glean from both of you and do my part.
Thank you. Yes. Thank you so much.
Yes, so you are so welcome. And for everyone watching, whether you're watching live now or replay, you've heard this conversation. You've heard the challenge that's been put out there. So I challenge you to take the words to heart and to be a part of making a difference and literally changing we can't change history, but we can change the effects of history so you have a much brighter, hopeful, promising future.
Absolutely.
Yes. Thank you.
Everyone have a fabulous day and a safe and healthy weekend. And as always, thank you for supporting Southern Inspirations. And I always end with, if you are a leader or know a leader of a nonprofit organization who would like to do this, just to have a conversation, get the word out there, drive awareness and engagement, please let me know. I'm always looking to do good nonprofit stories. So, all right, guys, I'm sure Lauren's in there getting hungry. Y'all better go feed that boy.
Well, his big sister is in there helping out.
So. Okay. Well, y'all take care and we'll be in again soon.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Bye-bye.